Dear ladies and gentlemen, thank you for coming today. My name is Denis Kononeko, and 1 month ago I finished my master's study at the Tarasa Shevchenko National University of Kyiv. And today I want to present to your attention a report on the topic curvilinear one-dimensional antiferromagnets. My talk is dedicated to the theoretical investigations of curvilinear one-dimensional antiferromagnets. Let's start with the motivation of our study. So let's start with motivation. Our study is motivated by the crucial advances in nanotechnology, which allows creation of nano-sized magnetic objects with complex geometry, like magnetic nano-sized wires and structural elements of stretchable and flexible magnetic electronics. Practical application for fabrication of such objects to use antiferromagnets. Several advantages over ferromagnets. First, antiferromagnets have zero, relatively small total magnetization and consequently don't interact with each other. Secondly, characteristic frequencies of antiferromagnets are several orders higher than those of ferromagnets. Moreover, some metal organic compounds can also have the antiferromagnetic ordering, such as metallized molecules of DNA or molecules of tetramethyl ammonium manganese chloride. Before we start, we proceed with description of such an one-dimensional antiferromagnet. Let's take a look on some examples of geometry-induced effects in one-dimensional ferromagnets, which are basically well studied. The simplest object to display the interplay between geometry and magnetic structure is domain wall. So let's consider a straight ferromagnetic wire with a tangential type of anisotropy. Such system, these two domain walls have equal energy. But if we bend the wire, this symmetry is broken and the domain wall on the right panel has lower energy than that on the left panel. Moreover, additional stabilization factor appears. The domain wall is pinned in the point of maximal curvature. Another interesting effect is all geometry-induced chirality break. We know that in the straight ferromagnetic wire, we see tangential anisotropy in equilibrium state. Magnetization is aligned straightly along the wire. But if we bend it in the helix, there in equilibrium state, magnetization is tilted from the tangential direction, and the direction of this tilt is different for right-handed helix and left-handed helix. So it depends on the chirality of the helix. Now let's proceed with the description of one-dimensional curvilinear antiferromagnet. In our study, we consider a chain of classical magnetic moments with antiferromagnetic ordering on the space curve gamma, for such with curvature kappa and torsion sigma. For such a curve, a local normalized curvilinear reference frame with tangential, normal, and binormal basis vectors can be introduced. In the approximation of continuous media, the magnetic structure of this antiferromagnet can be presented via the sublattice magnetization M1 and M2, or via nil vector and total magnetization vectors. We will consider antiferromagnet in long wave and low frequency spectral regions where it's where total magnetization acts as a slave variable. Thereby, statics of dynamics of such an antiferromagnet can be described only in terms of nil vector. In system, we consider the nearest neighbor Heisenberg exchange interaction with exchange integral J, which is positive, and magnetic dipole-dipole interaction. In the approximation of continuous media, the following macroscopic energy correspond to the exchange Hamiltonian, whereas magnetic dipole-dipole interaction can be reduce it to the hot tangential anisotropy, this constant K, determined by the zeta Riemann function. This approximation works for the wires which characteristic curvature and torsion radius are much larger than the distance between the magnetic moments. So it's not extremely compressed distance. In the frame of these interactions, antiferromagnet is described by the we are saying the nonlinear anisotropic sigma model with following Lagrange function density. Here all spatial variables are reduced on the magnetic length. So it, in the case of curved system, anisotropy term depends on the spatial this anisotropy which induced by dipole-dipole interaction depends on the spatial variable. Thereby it is convenient to provide this expression in the Curvilinear reference frame, where anisotropy is invariant with respect to the spatial translations. In Curvilinear reference frame, the exchange energy term can be presented in the form of three terms. The third term, second term, has a form of effective Dzerzhinsky moral interaction with coefficients f which are linear with respect to the torsion and curvature. And third term has a form of effective anisotropy with the coefficients quadratic with respect to curvature and torsion. But thus, the intrinsically chiral curvilinear antiferromagnets behaves as a chiral heavy magnet with geometrically tunable Dzerzhinsky moral interaction and biaxial anisotropy with hard axis along the E1 axis, which is induced basically by dipole-dipole interaction, and easy axis along the E3 line. This is purely a geometry induced. The geometry induced chiral interaction can be presented in the this effective form with the Dzerzhinsky vector aligned in the TP plane. Now let's illustrate this approach on the example of geometry with constant geometric parameters, ring and helix. The Lagrange function density of the helix has, in the terms of angular parameterization of the mean vector in the local reference frame, has the following form. The appropriate expressions for the ring can be obtained from these expressions for zero torsion and appropriate periodic boundary condition for angles. Now let's proceed with the description of equilibrium states in this system. It shows that ring has only one ground state in which mean factor is perpendicular to the plane of the ring, whereas helix has at least two equilibrium states. It's homogeneous state in which the mean vector is tilted from the binormal direction on angle determined by curvature and torsion, and periodic state. By comparing the energies of these both states, we determine the energetically preferable states for particular curvature and torsion. Here on this diagram, we can see that homogeneous states is more energetically preferable for helices with curvature relatively larger than torsion and periodic vice versa. In this diagram, the red solid line corresponds to the false boundary between states. Dashed blue line determines the asymptotics of this boundary in case of small curvatures. And solid black line determines the region of linear stability of homogeneous state. So in the region of the geometric parameters between the black and red lines, the homogeneous state is metastable. Now we proceed with the description of linear dynamics in this system. We can consider linear excitation on the background of ground state in the ring. We show that the magnon spectrum in the ring is dispersed. Thus, for each azimuthal quantum number n, which determines the number of periods of magnons on the ring, corresponds to frequency levels. The low frequency corresponds to the transversal mode, and a high frequency corresponds to the longitudinal mode. On the left panel, you can see the dependence of frequency on the curvature of the ring for asymptotic quantum number equals zero. It's homogeneous, it's oscillations. For asymptotic quantum number equals one, it's one period based on the ring equals two. Here's a lines correspond to the analytic prediction, and symbols correspond to the results of numerical simulations. Now let's proceed with the description of magnon linear excitation in the antiferromagnetic helix wire. Here we also investigate the excitation, linear excitation on the background of homogeneous state. The magnon dispersion in the antiferromagnetic helix is presented by the two dispersion branches, both low frequency and high frequency, and the gap of both branches are modified by curvature and torsion. Here it will be instructive to make a reference to the well-known results for straight antiferromagnetic spin chains with hard tangential type of anisotropy. So the plane perpendicular to the chain is easy plane. In such systems, there are two types of excitation. It's of magnets. It's first is in plane, it's oscillation in the easy plane. This type of modes has the linear dispersion with no gap. And second type is out of plane oscillations. It's out of easy plane. This is gapped dispersion. And important that in the straight system, these modes are excited individually. But if we bend it in spiral, these modes are coupled by the geometrically induced Dresden-Curvilinear interaction. Thereby, they excite it simultaneously, and additional gap appears for the this gapless linear range. Moreover, the geometry-induced Dresden-Curvilinear interaction results in the emergence of a region with negative group velocity, followed by the local minimum of dispersion curve with the depth delta. And the depth of this minimum delta increases with the curvature and torsion. So to sum up, in this talk we show that magnetic dipole-dipole interaction induces the hard tangential anisotropy and antiferromagnetic one-dimensional curvilinear spin chains. We show that the antiferromagnetic helix has at least two equilibrium states periodically homogeneous. And we also show that magnon spectrum is discrete, and magnon spectrum in the helix is modified both by curvature and torsion. Now this result of this project are submitted to the archive and will be submitted to journal ASAP. And thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Denis. Mm-hmm. And of course, Sasha has a question.
Okay, also I have a question, of course. So first I wanted to clarify, so your z direction, what is it? It is real, or it is, because I missed it probably. The main scene actually. What is z direction? What does it mean?
Z direction is just a direction of the corresponding Cartesian reference frame in which the geometry is placed.
So you make
all stuff made in the local reference frame. So
somehow it doesn't work. So you made such a, you calculate such a structure, right?
We can see the all dynamic and static states of the this structure in local reference frame with no z direction.
There is no z direction. I mean,
describe all static and dynamic state in local reference frame, not in the laboratory reference frame.
Yes. Okay. Actually, the question was whether you have some commensurability between this period which you have here in Z, and the period of your oscillations, let's say, of momentum. Especially interesting, this is if you have one turn and two turn, is there any difference?
No. The theory is written for the infinite system.
Yes.
So it's a lot of loops, a lot of steps.
Okay, probably.
Just an example.
Probably later.
do we have other questions online or?
But it's a very practical. Yeah. It's a very practical. Maybe can you show the geometry? You had one of those slides where it's gray. Yeah. So can you show where's the z-axis here?
Again, the z-axis is along the line. Along the axis of the fields.
Yeah, so it's really shown there. The point of the z-axis is a local axis.
It's laboratory axis. Z-axis is laboratory.
So now question, if I may. So you showed there's this, maybe some people call Houghton minimum, right? So at the finite k, there's the minimum of the maximum dispersion. So is the instability that you see there related to this minimum going to zero?
I can see we didn't analyze the stability. It's open question.
Further questions? So I have one of my own. How close are we to realizing these things experimentally? So artificial design in the lab.
Concerning the metallized molecules, we are quite close, we can do it. But concerning some wires, it's hard.
Okay, thank you. Further questions or comments? So we thank you again.